Hello and welcome to a Zipless Any% Guide for Warrior Within. Before we get started, I need to mention that in your game installation directory, you can delete or rename the videos folder, and that will prevent the game from playing the pre-rendered cutscenes. They don't really add anything to the game from a speedrunning perspective, and the game's just more enjoyable to play when you don't have to watch them. If for some reason you don't want to get rid of them, you can just remove however much time they add up to from your timer. Next thing I need to mention is that this route is PC only. Most of the important tricks we're going to be doing just don't work on platforms other than PC. With all that out of the way, we'll go ahead and jump into a new game on easy. We're gonna start off by mashing primary attack. I'm going to do this tutorial assuming you have beaten the game casually so that you just know how to play it in general. This weapon I've picked up, the dark sword with the gold embroidery, is one of the two good weapons. The silver sword on the ground over here, that is the bad weapon. You don't want to pick that one up. The other good weapon is the axe, which I don't think I need to show a visual of. I'm sure you can imagine what it looks like. So pretty much just follow along with me up to this point. You kill the two in the beginning, then the next two, and then you kill those four. Now this next bit, you need to stand in a very specific place to get the cutscene to play. Right where I was standing right there, you can go back and pause on that if you need to. Then you just walk around this corner. And I apologize that I'm moving a little quickly. This intro area is time constrained. I can't just stand around or things will move into a state that I'm not familiar with, and from there I can't really explain what to do. Once we get down here, you climb out to the left a little bit, hold block, and begin rolling. This is called side rolling. It's the fastest way to move in the game. It has two major flaws. If you're in combat, you can only side roll around the enemy you're in combat with. You can't side roll away from them. And the other big flaw is that if you go around a corner too tight, the camera will snap into position and that causes you to lose the ability to steer. So, as you saw, I didn't lose the ability to steer when I went around that corner, and that's because I did it in a very specific way. Try to match my movement on that as closely as possible. That is actually way more difficult than it looks, and it will take you a lot of practice to get it. If it's giving you too much trouble, feel free to just walk down the hallway. It only loses like 5 seconds. But yeah, once we get into this cutscene, we have a moment here where we just get to sit back and relax. I'm going to show you the fastest way to do this next part, although it has a chance to not work. It's a random chance thing, and there are multiple ways to do this section. So I'm going to start out by walking around the enemy in front of me. I'm going to do some backflips and then try to side roll. All of that may happen or none of it may happen. It just depends. Okay, so that's one of the big random elements right there, is the guy I ended up in combat with. How quickly he kills his AI enemy is very random. If he takes long enough, you can side roll right by him, but if he does it quickly, then you end up in combat with him, and you have to shimmy around the corner like that. But yeah, if it wasn't obvious, if that had not happened, I would have just side rolled around the corner and into the cutscene. So now we're in our first boss fight. We're going to begin this fight by holding block and walking towards her, and we're going to do secondary weapon counters. Then jump over her and do two primary attacks. That ends phase one. Now we're going to repeat that. This is called a blade battle. You just mash primary attack to get through it. When she does those leg sweeps, you have to delay your counterattack. And as you saw, if you go too early, she'll knock you down, which is really bad. So that's something you'll need to practice. I am particularly bad at it. Once you do one more set of counterattacks, though, the fight will be over. And we will end up on the island. This is really where the game begins. That first bit was more like a little tutorial area. On my live split at the very bottom, you'll notice I have a row titled Story Counter, which is currently at 1. That is a add-on that we've made for live splits, and I will explain what it does shortly. First, I need to mention that once you come out of that cutscene, you roll over to this line in the wall and wall run up to skip this area. It only works if you wall run in that particular place. Then you get over to this cutscene, jump up here, and from here it's mostly just basic platforming efficiency. It's really, there aren't any big fancy skips or anything. But as I was saying, the story counter is an add-on that analyzes the memory values of the game, one in particular, the one that determines how far in the story you are. We're going to be doing a glitch later that will allow us to edit that memory value, and so having that little add-on there makes it a lot easier for us to know if we succeeded. You can find a link to that in the description. Real quick here, I need to mention, if you try to wall run up this wall and the prince won't go up it, it's because it hasn't loaded properly. That happens sometimes. The way you fix it is by rolling into the wall just like that, and then you'll be able to run up it just fine. Do that little jump to save some time, and we make our way around here. You can either turn around and wall run up the wall, or I usually wall run up the pillar. One thing I've seen certain runners do is to go into landscape here and do side rolls, but I find that very difficult, so I usually just do a couple of normal rolls, and that's what I was trying to do, was wall run over there. Pull out your sword during this wall run, that way you can do side rolls as soon as you land. And then you can jump up here and do more side rolls. Once we get into this cutscene, we have a moment to relax. If you die during this intro section of the game, it's pretty unforgiving. It usually sends you back very far. So you'll want to become very familiar with the intro section of this game. I would say like the first 10 minutes or so, just because dying in them is usually grounds for a reset. You may as well just give up there, unless you are setting your first time ever. So at the end of this cutscene, I'm going to try and jump over an enemy. I may roll around him. I seem to be one of the only people who has that happen, and I'm not sure why. Either case works just fine. The one in the lower right, there I was able to jump over him. You shuffle to the side, do some backflips, and then side roll away. The backflips are just to get you far enough away from the enemies that your side rolls don't get caught up in within combat range. Then you make your way over to this cutscene where we meet the Crowman. He's big and scary, but we actually don't have to fight him. It's nice. So I'm going to show you the fast way to do this fight first, which is to side roll by him. And then to wall run in this corner and do a jump. The placement on that is a little tricky, which is why some people don't like to do that. Alternatively, you could have rolled right over there. That doorway is where we came from. You could have rolled over here and done a max height wall run, and then done a triple jump like that to get up here. In either case, you end up right here and you do a wall run like this and then one like this. The Crowman will say something taunting at you, but it doesn't really matter. We've got better places to be. This platform I've just stood on is a checkpoint. So if you die from here on out, it'll take you to there. Do this wall run. These enemies are very random. As you saw, that guy was ready to hit me before I even fell off the curtain. But sometimes you'll land from being off the curtain and they still won't know you're there. They're very strange. But yeah, and in either case, you just make your way over here to this corner. And this wall run is a little tricky. It'll take some getting used to, but it's really not that bad. Basically, the concept is that you're going to release wall run early so that you fall onto a ledge. And it looks like that. And then you go around this corner, drop down and jump off. We're going to pull our sword out during this wall run so that we can do side rolls. This corner right here is another one where if you go around it too tight, the camera snaps and you can't steer the prince anymore. So we just went to the past and got our rewind time ability. So you can afford to make a couple mistakes now, but do your best not to, because we're going to need at least two sands for our first big glitch coming up. Tap away from this guy until you're out of combat, so you can start doing side rolls. There are a bunch of different ways to do this next room. I'm going to show you the safe but slow way, and then I'll explain the fast and sort of risky way. So hold block before the cutscene even ends. Begin side rolling. Go way over here, and I actually did a forwards roll there by mistake, but you would want to side roll all the way over here and then around this, and then do a wall run to jump over to the pillar like that. Now, the fast way is that's the doorway we started in. There would be a guy in the center of my screen right now. You would run over to him, vault over him, then do a wall run up that wall right there in the center of my screen, and jump from there to this pole. The danger is that the enemy might charge at you, which means when you jump off the wall, you'll jump over him instead of to the pole. The slow but safe route, as you saw, lured all the enemies away so that that couldn't happen. Once you climb up here, just jump on over. The closer you get to that corner, the better, but of course, if you aim too far to the left, you'll die. And you roll over here, and now we're going to do our first safety fall, as we call them. If you have your swords out while you're wall running and press secondary attack, you do a little spin attack. You can actually fall further distances without taking damage than if you jump off a wall. So we're going to use that to our advantage to skip sliding down that curtain. Now, if you already know what to do here, you just jump from here and then wall run up this wall, not along it. But if you're newer to the speedrun and you're still not very good at the first glitch, which is a little challenging, you want to go into landscape and side roll through here. One of the biggest perks to side rolls is that you can't be knocked over when traps damage you, so you can just roll right through those. And by drinking from this fountain, you set a checkpoint here. If you don't drink from that fountain, you go all the way back to that checkpoint at the beginning of the game I mentioned, in that room where we did the early release wall run. So it's quite a time loss. So drinking from that fountain is pretty important if you're not confident in your ability to do this next trick. Once you get up here, you drop off this edge. I use keyboard for this next section, even though I play with a controller most of the time. Climb up, turn around. Now I need to explain what we're going to do before I show it. We're going to do a rewind trick, which in essence means you rewind to the same spot in time twice. And you can extend the animation of certain movements like that, including jumps. So we're going to extend our jump to reach a pillar that we shouldn't be able to get to until much later in the game. The way I'm going to guarantee my aim is that I'm going to use the keyboard. I'm going to press A very shortly before I press space, and that's going to guarantee that I jump in the correct direction. Now, if you will, imagine the prince's jump creates an arc, right? Now split that arc into thirds. We want to rewind during the last third of the arc. If we end our rewind past the half waypoint, like towards where I'm standing now, then it's an automatic failure. We have to release rewind before we hit the halfway point. You want to rewind for about a half a second, maybe a little less, but you don't want to release rewind instantly. The important thing is that you rewind for a moment, and that creates a little space where you can rewind to for your second rewind. And if you do it correctly with the correct timing, you will end up extending your jump, and hopefully I can show it off on my first try here. I'm a little rusty with this. So there, I managed to get it, and as you saw, my jump got extended and I ended up on the pillar. It's important to get here with all three of your rewinds, because if you don't get it on the second one, you have one extra chance. But yeah, that's something you're going to want to practice a lot. Once you get on the pillar, you can, if you're too high up, you'll hit the top of this doorway and fall to your death. And if you're too low, you'll actually hit the wall down there and fall to your death. So you want to be just in the right place. And you can jump off, go out of landscape view, and grab a checkpoint at this fountain, which is necessary. The previous checkpoint we took was optional. This one you have to get because you immediately follow it up with suicide. And if you can't guess, the reason we did that is because the area ahead was not loaded, and now it is. Now pull out your swords here. We're going to side roll through here, right by these enemies. Once you get onto the spikes, pause for just a moment. That way you can avoid taking damage from those. Do it again. And then lastly, do it one more time. Now drop down here. If you moved here fast enough, you can get that first cycle. If not, you'll have to wait. Once you walk through this doorway, rewind until you kill yourself. There we go. Now, if you watch my story counter value, it'll go from 3 to 3. And I'm happy that happened because it gives me a chance to explain what to do now. So it was not supposed to stay at 3, if you can believe that. Sometimes it just doesn't work. It's performance related, unfortunately, and like, that's not what it sounds like. My computer is light years ahead of the best gaming PCs from when this game came out. It's, despite that, it still doesn't work sometimes. The way you fix it is simply by killing yourself again. I've never seen it happen 2 times in a row, so hopefully. There we go. Now it's a 58. So, what does that mean? That means we are now very close to the end of the game, because the last value that that story counter can hit that I'm aware of is 66. So yeah, as that fade in happens, you want to reset camera and then roll into this cutscene.
bring the platform to me.
Then you roll around here. Try not to jump onto that pillar. That was a mistake. Jump from these pillars to avoid that dog. Then jump from these. And then from this one, we're going to do a wall jump to land right here. Now you want to get the middle of the prince's head about lined up with the left edge of this beam. And then I use keyboard for this jump just to make it safe. I'm actually a little further on the edge here than I'd like, but I did make it. Once you get here, you can do a wall run and then some wall jumps. Drinking from this fountain will bring our story counter up to 59. Now we're going to suicide once again. It's very important you suicide right where I did, because you have to be in a certain loading zone when you die, or otherwise the trick doesn't work. Now you might notice I don't have a body, which is fine. We'll just do it again. That always happens. Just the game going through its phases, trying to figure out where the hell we are. Okay, now we're the Sand Wraith. Jump off here. I actually went a little too soon there. Side roll through that thing. And usually you wouldn't have to wait on this saw blade, but where I misplaced my jump earlier, that's why I have to. So, as Sand Wraith, our health slowly deteriorates until it hits 1/4. And our sands constantly refill, which is very important. We're going to be using that for a nice glitch coming up. As you saw, I didn't jump from the very edge of the first beam, and that's important, because if I had, I would have not been able to do that fancy jump I just did where I jumped from one end of the beam to the other. Okay, now we're gonna jump from the bottom of this curtain, and then begin doing side rolls. There are enemies on the other side of this room that we're side rolling away from. Now once you get to this doorway, do a max wall run right here, then some jumps, and I didn't do a max enough wall run. There we go. Now flip around 180 degrees and use first person camera to get as straight as possible. Reset camera, pull out your weapons and hold block. I use keyboard for this section as well. You want your left foot to be visible right there on those bricks, and you want to back up so your foot is just in front of that line in the bricks, and now go right until about half of your foot is in the wall. First person, turn to the left until that pillar over there is in the center of your screen. Now you want to throw your weapon to do a drop glitch. Basically, you can't take fall damage while you're in the throw weapon animation, and we're exploiting that to get down here. This should make things easier. Those are much easier to do in the sequel to this game, The Two Thrones, because you can do them off of regular ledges. In this game, you can only do them off of very specific circumstances, such as the one we were just in. So we just picked up the Scorpion Sword and the Cursed Axe. The Scorpion Sword is, I believe, the last sword in the game, unless you're doing True Ending, but I could be wrong about that. The Cursed Axe has no durability. It will never break, but it damages you down to 1/4 of your health every time you use it. Once you hear the door open sound, that means you're on the last enemy. As soon as he's dead, you can do side rolls to get out here, get in front of this door, and now wait a certain amount of time. The longer you wait, the safer it is, up to 10 seconds. At 10 seconds, you're pretty much completely safe. I usually wait about 5 to 7 seconds. Now we're going to be doing a glitch called Quicksand, which is it seems a little scary at first because of how much time it loses if you screw it up. But once you've learned to do it, it's really easy. It's a sand duplication glitch that allows us to slowly sink into the floor. So to start off, we're going to do a jump and then rewind to when we're not jumping. And now because we're Sand Wraith, that sand we're missing is going to come back. As soon as it does, I'm going to do that process again. I'm going to jump and rewind. I'm going to release my rewind when the sand tank is on the last frame of its emptying animation. The animation is, it's not smooth. It's only like 8 frames delayed over a course of a second or so. So when there's just a sliver of sand left in the tank is when I'm going to release, and then I'm going to keep doing that over and over, and it's going to keep coming back. We need to do this. I forgot that it refills when you're in the pause menu. So that's number 2. We need to do it 21 times. There's number 5. Here's number 10. This should be number 15. Okay, I'm pretty sure that was 21. You may have noticed that in the last half of that, the timing changed. The reason for that is the white bar in your medallion HUD, I'm going to call the rewind queue. And the rewind queue, as you're doing quicksand, it slowly empties. Once it reaches 0, your rewind stops immediately, and it just defaults you back to the end of your of the rewind queue in the internal game system. So once we get to the point where we're ending the queue, you don't have to release rewind. The game will do that for you, and it actually becomes faster. But yeah, so that's why the timing changed. Now that we've done this 21 times, I believe, we are short enough that we can actually fit under the hitbox for this door, which is pretty convenient because there's no other way to get in here, at least without doing a bunch of stuff that wastes a lot of time. So now that we're through, do a jump to pop out of the ground. Come over here, pull out your sword, and you want to be in about this position. We're going to activate the pause menu glitch. The way this glitch works, this is one of the big PC-only things. When we changed our story value from 3 to 58, that was also PC-only. Anyway, the pause menu glitch, you pause, press continue, and then mash pause shortly thereafter. As you'll notice, there's no red background. And if I press continue, the pause menu comes back up all on its own. This has some interesting properties, especially when you rewind. Some really devastating properties when you use slow-mo, but unfortunately we don't get to do that in this run. You get to do that in the true ending run of Zipless, but in this run, we're just going to be doing non-slow-mo launches. Basically, you want to hold, so I should mention, when you're in this mode, the prince puts his weapons away very quickly, so I pulled them out and held block, because as long as you're holding block, he can't put them away. Now I'm going to hold left on the analog stick so that he will wall run as soon as the menu closes, and before the menu comes back up, I need to do a secondary attack, the spin attack. Okay, so we got that part. Now I'm going to close the menu. Before he lands on the ground, I need to press rewind. So I didn't quite get it before he hit the ground, but this will probably still work. You go down, so I'm holding rewind this whole time. You can't let go. I come down to map and press it twice. You notice he moved a little. Now you press cancel to go out of the menu. It's the whatever button you use to like drop down from ledges. And shortly after I push cancel, I let go of rewind. Now I end up in this position, hold rewind, press cancel, and let go of rewind. And that happens, and I apologize that I didn't wait longer. If you wait too long in that spot, he'll actually die. So again, you can go back and rewatch that if you need to, but once you end up floating in midair like that with no menu, you hold rewind, press cancel, and then release rewind. And that launches you up here. We're not entirely sure why it works, but we have some ideas. That spin attack animation is one of the few things in the game that actually interacts well with the menu. Most stuff just doesn't do anything. Once we get over here, we're just going to do a little shortcut right there by doing a wall run to get up to those beams. Now we're going to do some rolls to get over to this door. Then we're going to break the door down. Try and get both of these enemies' attention, but that can be kind of difficult. So yeah, this is super slow what I'm doing right now, and you shouldn't do it in a run. Ideally, they'll both attack you right when you walk in, but that hardly ever happens. If they don't, just go ahead and kill them separately. The best way to kill them is to... Here, let me get in a better position. Is to... You're disappointing me, my prince. Well, that's not what I meant to do. Sorry, this is kind of difficult to gauge how to get through since they're in positions I've never dealt with. Basically, you while holding block, you let them hit you, but you're blocking, so you don't take damage. Then you hold away from them on the analog stick so that the prince takes one step away from them. When he does that, they won't attack you. Then you do primary, secondary to do the fancy spin attack I was doing. There we go. And as you saw, I was able to cut through them quite quickly like that. I apologize it took me so long to get to that point. So now you do a wall run here. Pull out your swords, do a wall run, reset camera to make sure everything's lined up straight. Walk backwards until the prince's left foot is on that line on the table. And the position here is pretty important, so make sure his foot is like right on that line. Pretty close up to the front of the, like, where the line ends. Now activate the pause menu glitch. Now we're going to close the menu, delay a little bit of time. Basically, when he's going to stop blocking and then start blocking again, even though I'm holding block the whole time. Once he starts blocking again, we're going to jump up against the wall. That puts us into this position. I may not have waited long enough, actually. We'll see. As soon as I close the menu this time, I'm going to begin mashing secondary attack. And yeah, that happened because I did not delay long enough before I did my jump. So let me get back into position here. We're basically going to trick the game into doing the wall run spin attack, even though we're not wall running. This is only possible during the menu glitch. That's much better. Okay, so he's doing the spin attack now. We're going to close the menu and hold, but press rewind before he hits the ground, hopefully. There we go. Tap map twice, cancel and release. Hold rewind, cancel and release. And that lands us here. Now you'll notice we can walk into this wall. The reasons for that are about to become apparent. This wall run is a little tricky, but you wall run to the left here to activate this cutscene, which causes that wall to fall off, which is why we could walk through it. Because we've entered this area a bit backwards, the Dahaka gets pretty confused and just leaves us alone. If you die, you get respawned to this chase, and he does chase you at that point, but for right now, we're safe. we get up here. And suddenly he remembers us again. Here you want to reset camera real quick, and you can take a drink if you want to restore your health and set a checkpoint. But hopefully, fingers crossed, I won't need to do that. This cutscene is very short. You want to immediately side roll to the right after it's over, because if you wait too long, you'll enter combat. But if you go immediately, you'll be able to roll past all the enemies. Hug this left wall, that's what I was trying to say. Then hug the right wall. Once you get over here, tap wall run, do a safety fall. Then wall run here to kill that dog. Then come over here, you'll see this white mark on the wall to the right of my head. You want to be just left of that before you start doing your wall jumps. This cutscene trigger over here is so huge, we can actually hit it by jumping to our death. If you want to see something funny, mash jump when you do that. The beginning of the cutscene will look a little funky. If only I could see through this fog. If only we could see through this fog, let me tell you. So this area sucks. We're going to start off by mashing the throw weapon button, and that is going to instantly kill one of the dogs. One dog down. Now come stand over here. You want to wait on one of the dogs to try and jump at you, and then jump over to this platform to the right, and that'll cause the dog to jump to its death. So I actually waited a little too long there because I was paused explaining. There you saw the dog die. So now we're down to two. And two is very manageable. So we're just going to roll around here. Do a wall run right here. Step on this button now. Really dumb thing about the designers of this game. They made it so that the timer for how quickly the door closes runs during this cutscene. So the first time you press the button, you have significantly less time to get through the door than any other time you press the button. The really safe thing to do here is to wait on the button to come back up and press it again, and then to take the normal route where you hop from pillar to pillar. If you want to make it through the first time, you actually have to jump off of the second pillar and run to the door, which with dogs in the way can be very hard. One of the dogs that exists, that we left alive right now, is in a very bad spot, but I'll see if I can get by him. It's a little random where they end up, you just gotta hope that they go somewhere that's not too terrible. So I tried to roll past him there, but I couldn't quite get it. Then I let go of rewind too soon. Oh, do it. If I can save this. You want to do a jump around this corner here to save time. And I am having a hell of a hard time with this. There we go. There we go. That was very sloppy, and that's because I got a really bad placement for the dogs. But yeah, usually you saw the two jumps I did where I cut corners. Use that to get around the dogs, and you can get through the door in time. Or like I said, if that's too risky for you or you're having trouble getting it consistently, you can just wait by the button, wait for it to pop back up, and then push it again. I want to say that loses like 20 seconds or something, so it's not too terrible. So yeah, now we come down here and break that wall to get this Easter egg weapon called the Light Sword. It does a ton of damage. It also, like the Cursed Axe, damages us when we use it, but that's not really a concern for us. There are actually blades in the fog there, so you have to wall run, which conveniently kills that shade. Then you side roll away to get over here. By the way, if you feel like I didn't adequately explain anything and you have questions, feel free to leave a comment and I'll try and get to you as soon as I can. We also have a Discord, if I didn't mention that yet, for the Prince of Persia runners, and you can feel free to ask for an invite to that, and then you can ask all of the runners questions. Once you get over here, you just wall run to this rope. Sometimes you'll wall run through it for absolutely no apparent reason. You just have to rewind and try again. Once you get over here, you go down to this rope. You can go to the bottom instantly by holding a wall run. Then you get over here, set up some more side rolls. This is another corner where the camera can snap if you're not careful. Right here, we're going to tap wall run and do, well, we're gonna die apparently. Tap wall run and do a safety fall to land down here. This jump is pretty tricky. It's going to take you a little bit of practice. You have to be running when you do this jump, or otherwise you won't make it far enough, and you need to jump from the very edge. You want to be aimed at the left piece of whatever the hell these things are. But you want to land right here. And the hitbox for you were never meant to touch these, so their hitboxes are a bit wonky. This one, for instance, is like I can go way out here where I'm standing on air. You want to wall run up just a tiny bit and then jump, which lands you down here. You hop over this, do more side rolls. At the top of the stairs here, I'm going to touch the door, and that's going to spawn traps in the next room, and they will be out of my way by the time I get in there, which is very convenient. And I'm not sure why he's refusing to grab on, but you can wall run up this as well. When you come out here, be careful you don't drop off the edge, because that's not what you want. You actually want to go around the corner like that. Do a jump there. Then climb over this fence. Do a jump. And then a jump and a wall jump. And then drop down. Now go left here and jump to your death. I know it sounds a bit funny, but then rewind back. And what jumping to our death did was disable a cutscene that we would otherwise have to watch when we go down that ladder. You're supposed to have slow-mo to get by this, but the way you do it without slow-mo is jump when the thing is in front of you. And by the time that your hands react and the prince actually moves, it'll be out of your way. Just like that, and that was actually pretty sloppy, but it worked. It's pretty hard to screw that trick up, honestly. Once you get over here, you want to go into landscape view and side roll through this door. Don't worry about this guy, just side roll between his legs. He doesn't matter. Go around that corner. You can exit landscape once you're over here. Why fight bosses when you can just leave them behind? Hold wall run as you're getting off of this. You can, if you don't screw it up a couple times, you can do side rolls. I like to climb on top of that and do a wall run. And then I don't know why he didn't, but you can wall run on this thing as well, which lands you directly on the ladder. Here you tap wall run and then jump at the last possible second to land on the lever. You have to, even once it hits the bottom, you have to wait longer for the door to finish going up for some reason. Roll under, and here I like to do a wall run. And that was actually a bad timing on my part. Usually it's not in that position. I'm not sure why this is happening. Once you get over here, we're gonna end up taking the mask off and stop being Sandwraith. Which is good because we stop taking damage, but it's bad because we stop regenerating sand. And having spent most of the run as Sandwraith, it's very easy to get used to the idea that you'll never run out of sand, which is dangerous because we really need to keep our sand for this next part. We're going to use it to skip two very long cutscenes, and if we can't skip those, the run is just dead. Now, of course, if you're, you know, just setting your first time or something, then it doesn't really matter that much. But once you're trying to improve your time, it's pretty important. We drink from this fountain to get our health back. Technically, you don't have to, but it's incredibly risky not to. And I like to side roll through those just in case they damage you so you don't get knocked down. Can do that over here again. Here you have to wait just a moment for the trap to start moving. And if you jump before you go under the black line, you can grab directly onto this ledge instead of the one below it. Drop down, do a wall run. Here you can jump to the ladder before you can even see it. And grab onto this lever. Now we're coming up on the first cutscene skip. So something we haven't done with the pause menu yet are teleports. We don't really know why these work either. But basically you get into this position, I line myself up with the right edge of that black spot on the ground. Hold forwards and wall run. Now, it's important that you're in the menu for a moment. If you do this too quickly, it will fail. I would, until you get used to it, I would at least wait 2 seconds after opening the menu before continuing. But once you get used to it, you can kind of feel it out for yourself. But I've been in here plenty long at this point, so I just hold rewind, press map, cancel, and release, and that teleports me past the cutscene trigger. Now we're going to do that again, but a bit more complicated this time, because we have to delay our wall run for this one. So I use keyboard here, I hold shift and walk forwards, and that lines you up perfectly because you're against a wall. You can reset camera here. Once the prince's left foot is in front of that line in the bricks, you can turn around. I use first person to line myself up like this. Now we activate pause menu. So how long do you need to delay? I really can't put it into numbers, honestly. It's just something that I kind of feel out, and I actually am not that great at this skip. That's probably okay. We'll see. So yeah, that worked. So yeah, if you miss that one, you get an incredibly long cutscene. The first one is kind of long, but this one's really long. After you get it, you want to wall run right here, and that is to hit a loading trigger that doing the teleport missed. Then we side roll over here. And I know my explanations on those teleports was a bit vague, but I feel like if you go back and listen to what I said and try and watch me do it, it's really not that hard to figure them out. The important part is that you're waiting in the menu for a moment and that you're releasing rewind immediately after you press cancel and not releasing it at the same time or a significant amount of time later. Make sure you heal here. It's very important to go into the final boss with full health. Want to wall run up this. You time this correctly. And land where I did, and then wall run again, which is very fast. But I can't really... There we go. I couldn't really show it off without dropping down there, but as you saw, I was able to just wall run right over to the next area. You want to side roll here, wall run there. Now come out here a little and aim towards the right edge of that like rectangular thing sticking out of the wall. Do a jump to land right there. We're almost to the end. Pull your sword and do side rolls. And don't wall jump like a fool. Alright, so the Kylina fight. Sorry, I needed to readjust myself for this. The Kylina fight, which involves what we call triple skip. It's pretty hard, honestly, to do it every time. And if you get a good run all the way to this point and then lose it to triple skip, it's very sad. The big downside here is that the last skip and triple skip is random. Yeah, you can do everything right and it still won't work sometimes. So unfortunately, that's just something you have to live with this game. So we start out by mashing secondary attack, which may not work for me. For some reason, it doesn't sometimes, even though it works for everyone else. Okay, so as you saw, it didn't work for me. I ended up having to parry. As long as you parry quickly and she only gets one hit in on you, that's fine. If she gets more than one hit on you, then it gets pretty dangerous because we're going to take damage on purpose in the next section. As you saw, she blocked me. When she does that is a little random. The way you counteract that is by walking to the right and attacking her as she's getting ready to attack you. The timing on it is pretty precise. Go back and watch me do it a couple times and then try it out for yourself and just keep practicing it. It's something that you get better at every time you do it. In this next section, we're going to mash secondary attack again. That almost always works for me here, just as often as it does for everyone else at least. The first time? That's what I've been trying to tell you. If you just let me explain. In this one, she's going to block us again, and we're going to have to walk around her again, and then we'll end up in a blade battle, and I'll explain what to do from there. Okay, so now we lose the blade battle on purpose, and this is why it's so important that we parry quickly in the prior phase, so that we have enough health to survive losing the blade battle. Because you have to remember, every time we use the light sword, it damages us, but it does so much damage to her that it's worth it. So as we're losing the blade battle, like once the camera returns to normal, you want to activate slow-mo. Again, I'm assuming you've beat this game, but if you don't know, Kylina has these phases where she spawns sand tornadoes, and they're very slow and annoying, and that's what the triple skip is. We're trying to skip all three of those. So once we're in slow-mo, every time she blocks, just walk a little. Okay, so I've got her to the correct amount of health. You want her 3 hits from dead. As the slow-mo is ending, jump over her. That was perfect. Now this is the random part. Even though I jumped over her perfectly, she may immediately start in a tornado and there's nothing I can do to stop that. Jumping over her increases the likelihood that that will not happen, but it can still happen. Basically, just mash secondary at the end of this cutscene and hope that the game ends. And it worked. She usually doesn't block there. That was a little scary. But as soon as that last hit lands, you end your timer. I'm actually going to... Let me try that again. I'm actually going to load up the last save real quick so I can show you what to do if you do end up in a tornado cycle. Yeah, that one should work just fine. Unfortunately, we have to platform all the way back to her. But yeah, the key to success in triple skip is being good at those counter attacks where you walk around her. You have to be really confident and good with those, and I keep screwing this up for some reason. There we go. And you also hopefully you don't have the issue that only seems to happen on my PC, where mashing secondary just isn't good enough for the first phase. Everyone else says that's really easy for them, but I find no matter how fast I mash, it just doesn't work. I'm not sure why, but it might be a hardware-related thing, I'm not sure. If it's not working for you, like me, like I said, just do a parry attack to get out of it.
I know what you've seen, what you think you've seen in the timeline.
Then you know I have no choice.
I'm just going to get through the first phase here so I can get her to spawn tornadoes.
And for you to die.
See, that time it did work for me, which is very unusual. And this time she blocked twice, which is a thing that can happen, so be ready for that.
This isn't what happened the first time we fought.
The first time?
That's what I've been trying to tell you. If you...
So I'm just going to not attack her here, so that she'll spawn tornadoes, but obviously under normal circumstances you would want to mash secondary attack at the end of this cutscene. So when this happens, do rolls around this circle. The only time that the tornadoes have a good chance of hitting you is when she spawns them when you're doing this. But after they're spawned, as long as you change direction regularly, it's really hard for them to hit you. Also important to note, when the tornadoes dissipate, they drop sand. So if you end up having to rewind to save your own skin, you can get your sand back from these. Oh, and I just remembered in the third phase of my last fight, you can slow-mo there if you so please. And that's probably why she blocked me and I wasn't expecting it, is because I didn't slow-mo. After the tornadoes disappear, she keeps floating for a while. You want to slow-mo as soon as she stops, because otherwise she might just start doing another one immediately. I think that's everything. If you have any more questions, again, leave a comment or ask for an invite to the Discord. I hope you all enjoy running this game as much as I do. Thank you for watching.